The topic I've chosen for this installment is not like the others I've already covered. Up to this point, the arguments have been refutations of proofs of God's existence. Today's topic concerns the argument that man, for the sake of society, simply needs a faith in God independent of the fact of God's existence. This is a common argument. It concerns the idea that a person who has no faith in God has no moral compass by which to judge the rightness or wrongness of a thing. It suggests, rather piously, that those who do not believe in God are less restricted by their mores, since there is no creator to answer to in their personal moral code. Aside from the fact that this is simply offensive, it is demonstrably incorrect. Many animals have social mores, and they have no knowledge of deities to guide them whatsoever. Unless, that is, you want to suggest that elephants have their own religions, or that wolves and gibbons have an innate knowledge of Jehovah. I suppose, though, that it could be argued that since Satan has no interest in the souls of animals, they are free from his duplicitous appeals to sin. Even were this so, the argument still has no defense against what is known as Euthyphro's dilemma. Euthyphro was a student of Socrates who was persecuting his own father for impiety. When Socrates asked him why he did this, he answered that the gods demanded it. Years later, Plato recounted the following exchange in a dialogue. And what do you say of piety, Euthyphro? Is not piety, according to your definition, loved by all the gods? Certainly. Because it is pious or holy, or for some other reason? No, that is the reason. It is loved because it is holy, not holy because it is loved. Euthyphro had no answer. The fact that they were talking about the Greek pantheon and not monotheism is not significant. The same dilemma applies. Is a thing good simply because God says it is? Or does God say a thing is good because of some other quality? If so, what is that quality? Obviously, if God says a thing is good because of innate qualities inherent in that thing would be good regardless of God's approval. Therefore, if this is the answer, then I don't need God to know that a thing is good or proper or decent. On the other hand, if these things or actions are not inherently good unless God deems them so, then we have no hope of ever knowing if something is always going to be good, or if a change of God's whim will suddenly render that which was good today evil tomorrow, or even if such a change of whim has already occurred in the intervening 2 millennia since God last spoke. Biblical examples of such whims exist. Many things are listed in one part of the Bible as acceptable under certain conditions that we consider wrong today. These things include slavery, rape, human sacrifice, theft of property, genocide, terrorism, vandalism, and polygamy, to name a few. Moreover, if it is so that a thing is only good if and because God wills it so, then that thing has no actual quality of goodness. Good and bad are arbitrary except as defined by God. Therefore, God himself is not good except that he declares himself so. God's only goodness will be his power and authority. Or, as Bertrand Russell put it, if you are quite sure there is a difference between right and wrong, you are then in this situation. Is that difference due to God's fiat, or is it not? If it is due to God's fiat, then for God himself there is no difference between right and wrong, and it is no longer a significant statement to say that God is good. If you are going to say, as theologians do, that God is good, you must then say that right and wrong have some meaning which is independent of God's fiat, because God's fiats are good and not good independently of the mere fact that he made them. If you are going to say that, you will then have to say that it is not only through God that right and wrong came into being, but that they are, in their essence, logically anterior to God. Of course, in a society such as ours, this point is moot anyway, since we are governed by laws, and these laws determine for us whether a thing is moral. Where laws do not impose themselves, we have a dynamic of group ethics. And where group ethics are not imposed, we have free will and personal responsibility. I submit that these are the things which truly dictate morality and not God's laws. I always end these with a quote from an atheist. Today's atheist is Arthur C. Clarke, and the quote is, "One of the greatest tragedies of mankind is that morality has been hijacked by religion." Thank you.